Welcome to Patent Law and Policy. I'm Polk Wagner, and together with Camilla Hardy, I'll be your instructor for this course. As you might imagine from the title, this course is intended to be a fairly comprehensive overview of the law and the policy of the United States patent system. But this course is also a testbed of sorts, a way of experimenting with some new teaching methods that we're trying out here at the law school. You're seeing one of those right now, which is the use of videos to convey some of the course content. The general idea here is to use our limited class time together to apply on and build on the substantive materials that you find in the readings, as well as use our class time to answer questions and clarify issues. We're going to still have the lectures covering reading materials, of course, but these are mostly going to be pre-recorded and posted online for you to watch prior to class. And then we can use the class time to run a series of weekly exercises that have been designed to integrate with the class materials and allow us to extend what we learned during the readings, and as well as be fun and I think probably more interesting than just lecturing. As always, I welcome your feedback and comments during the course or at the end of the course if you have thoughts about some of these new methods. And with that brief introduction, here's our first lecture for Patent Law and Policy, an introduction to patent law. This is Lecture Zero, an introduction to patent law. The agenda for this lecture has three components. We're going to begin with an overview of why one might be interested in studying patent law, what's going on with the system, some facts and figures, some trends, and so forth. We're going to then move to a discussion of the architecture of the patent system, the players are, who the players are, how the system operates, what a patent is, how do you get one, those sorts of basic issues. And then we're going to talk briefly about the course and the administration of the course at the end of the lecture. So first, why study patents? Well, there are several reasons to study patents. For one thing, patents are critical to national industrial policy and becoming more critical all the time. Certainly, any of you who read the newspaper know that. And really, this is a long-term trend. We've moved from the industrial age where the U.S. economy and indeed the world economy was dominated by manufacturing, large, heavy industries, and that is what the United States did in particular very well for a long period of time. But now we've moved into the information age, and what that really means is that manufacturing has, in particular in the U.S., but also in other major countries, ceased to be as important a component of the economy, and instead what we do increasingly is manipulate information. We create things, we invent things, we develop things, and less and less do we make things. And so the idea here is that patents are increasing importance as the information age matures, because they are critical to understanding and protecting the new assets of the new economy, which are, of course, increasingly intellectual assets. So rather than building large factories and having manufacturing plants and so forth, increasingly modern companies have intellectual assets, their knowledge, their know-how, their employees, and a big component of that is their intellectual property rights, including, and probably most importantly, their patent rights. Patenting is also spread across the economy. We will talk over and over again during the course about patents as being critical in particular in one area of the economy, and that is pharmaceutical drugs. And there's no doubt that patents are critically important to pharmaceutical drugs, but their impact is spreading, and it's not just sort of the drugs that get produced. You're seeing more and more patents that are being filed for basic ideas about research, right? So research procedures, research tools, the way that people do research is increasingly being patented as well. Genetic patenting is something we're going to talk about throughout the course. That is something you're seeing more and more of as more and more innovations, more and more research development dollars, more and more know-how is being applied to understanding
genetic material, the human body, how it works, you're seeing the patenting of that area increasing as well. Software is a big area of patenting in recent decades. Patenting of software has been going on since the late 80s. But of course, anyone who's paid any attention to what's going on in the economy knows that over the last 15 years or so, and even more so in the last 5 years or so, software has become probably the single biggest driver of the recent economic trends. And so it of course makes perfect sense that patenting would come to these areas. As companies invest significant amounts of resources into patenting in this area, they're going to, of course, try to get, you're going to see more and more patenting in the software industry, and I don't think we're going to see any end of that anytime soon. Software patenting, of course, those of you who read the newspaper are going to know, is pretty controversial. I'd say it's an uneasy fit between the patent system and software. There's a variety of reasons for that. One is that software innovations typically have a relatively rapid cycle, life cycle. A piece of software may be good for a few years, then it gets redesigned. Perhaps the hardware that it runs on becomes obsolete and so forth. Patents, of course, have a much longer time horizon. It can often take 2 or 3 years just to obtain a patent. And so therefore, the fit between protecting a software innovation and the patent system is a little bit uneasy. There are many who claim and who argue that the patent system is not well suited to software, that the way that some of the case law and statutory provisions operate don't sort of lend themselves to making good decisions in the software context, and we're going to explore that in the course. But just know, I just wanted to flag for you now that patenting of software is a important, increasingly important, and of course controversial area. You're even seeing patenting emerge in very traditional areas of business, such as finance, areas where even just a few years ago we really didn't think there was much room for patents, both because we didn't think there was a whole lot of new innovations available in those areas, as well as we thought that the fit, again, between these types of innovations and the patent system was not very good, and so therefore many people didn't bother, didn't think that patents were possible in these areas. And in fact, we found that there is a significant amount of patenting going on in these industries. We will cover many of these types of patents throughout the course. I'm sure that you've seen discussions about business method patents. There's a number of patents out there for financial derivatives and other types of financial products. Those raise important policy questions, again, similar to software, about whether the patent law and policy is well suited, ready to adapt to these new areas, but also about whether we should have patents in some types, some areas of our economy, where the argument goes that people would innovate in these areas regardless of whether or not the patent system was providing incentives, and so maybe we don't need patents in these particular areas. But again, this is an area where the patents have emerged because of a lot of economic interest, because this is what Americans do now, which is invent things in across the entire economy. And so the patent system is responding to that. And that, of course, creates pressure and challenges for the patent system, which is part of what we're going to study in this course. Another reason to study patents is because the patent law has been undergoing a significant amount of shift in recent decades. We'll talk throughout the course about a few of these very transformative events to flag a few here. One in particular is the creation of the United States Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit in 1982. The U.S. patent system is unique among federal substantive law areas in that it is a nationwide law. That is, the patent law applies federally. It's a federal law. But not only is it a federal law, but all appeals in patents come to a single appellate court. So, for example, a patent lawsuit filed in California at a district court in L.A., for example, in the Central District of California, if that gets appealed, and most patent cases are indeed appealed, that would come to the United States Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit in Washington, D.C., rather than the Ninth Circuit, right? So all of the other federal cases would end up at the Ninth Circuit, but the patent case would end up at the Federal Circuit. That, of course, as you might imagine, has very significant implications for the way that the law of patents has developed. It means that there's a single appellate court that sort of is astride all of patent law, which has both positive and negative attributes, of course, and most of all, as you might imagine, a lot of controversy. So that's a major change. This court is the newest federal court. Federal Court of Appeals was created in 1982. Just as an aside, it doesn't do only patents. It does about seven or eight areas of substantive law. Patent law is just one of those areas, but it occupies just about the majority of the court's time, and the rest of the substantive areas take up about the other 50%. Another major component of the recent changes in the patent law that we're going to talk about in this course is the American Invents Act of 2011. This 2011 law was the most comprehensive set of reforms since 1952. It was for a variety of reasons we'll talk about during the course. The patent law has been remarkably stable in terms of a lack of substantive changes over the last 50 years. 2011 is really the first time that we saw fairly widespread changes in the system, and we will be talking about the changes that that law made throughout. The big change here was a shift from what's known as a first-to-invent system to a first-to-file system. This is an important change in practice. What basically it says is that it used to be that the first, if you were in competition with somebody to obtain patent rights over an invention, where you were both, for example, working on the same invention, it used to be in the United States the first person who could prove that they invented the particular technology would get the patent. Now it is changed to a modified first-to-file system, where the first person who shows that they who files at the patent office an application for that technology is the one who gets the patent. Obviously, this changes incentives. The basic reason that we changed this was it improves our international harmonization. It means that the U.S. rules are now in line with what the rest of the world does. In fact, we were the last country in the world to have a first-to-invent system when we changed it in 2011. Other major changes in the American Invents Act, there's a post-grant administrative review system, which means after a patent gets granted, there's an administrative process whereby those patents can be reviewed. There's some expanded defenses for prior uses, some tightening of the venue requirements to try and eliminate some things that we'll talk about involving patent trolling. But that's those are the headlines of the American Invents Act of 2011. The other reason, the other things that have changed in patent law pretty remarkably over the last 20 or 30 years is that patents really have changed as the way that they are used in the economy. It used to be that you would think of patents as primarily protection for your product in the marketplace. So I would obtain a patent because I was creating, manufacturing, distributing a new invention, a new device, say a new golf ball, a new golf club, something like that, that was innovative, and therefore I would file for a patent primarily to protect my market position from my competitors being able to, say, copy my innovation and market their own copies of that. Now what you're seeing increasingly is that patents have value and are being thought of in the economy as their own assets. They have value just for the sake of being patents, and it's not so much that they are linked to any particular products in the marketplace. But it instead means that the patents themselves have independent economic value. That has a number of important changes. It changes the incentives for getting patents, right? You used to get patents primarily to protect yourself. Now you're getting patents to build assets. Now you might also be protecting yourself. That might also be a benefit, and that might still be a primary impetus for you doing it. But there's other reasons to get patents now, and there's other players now, right? There are people out there who are buying and selling patents, who are collecting patents, not because they have any plans necessarily to manufacture things based on these patents or to protect themselves in the marketplace on the basis of these patents, but merely because they think these patents might have important economic value. This changes things. It imposes a number of challenges with the patent system, as we'll talk throughout the course. A lot of the way that the patent system has been traditionally designed, thought about, talked about, may not really apply anymore. It may not apply in a world where patents are assets in and of themselves, and we need to try and figure out whether the patent system should be changed, whether we should try and curtail some of these new uses, and what to do about it. Another reason to study patents is that there's been a very significant expansion in patent activity over the last 20 years. If you look at the last two decades, the red line on the graph here are the applications filed at the U.S. Patent Office. The green is how many patents were granted. You can see a rise from 1994. You know, we were in the around 100,000 or so patents granted. Now we're at about 325,000 patents granted per year. That's a pretty big change, 3.5 times the number of patents granted. The change has even been bigger when you look at the applications filed. We've gone from around 200,000 patents applied for in 1994 to well north of 550,000, almost 600, just over 600,000 in 2014. So that is a huge increase in patenting behavior. People are patenting much more. They're filing more applications. More patents are being granted. This has a number of important challenges, and one of which can be seen on this graph, which is that the Patent Office has had a tremendous backlog. The yellow-orange line here shows pending applications, and you can see that as over the last 20 years, the amount of applications pending, meaning those that are in the Patent Office at the USPTO waiting for processing or being processed, has exploded to well north of 1 million, and really been pretty stubborn in terms of the Patent Office's ability to cut significantly into that set of numbers. This has been a major initiative of the past, in particular the past couple of commissioners of patents. It's been an extremely difficult thing to deal with, to get a handle on this pendency issue. And you can see there are still well more than 1 million patents pending at the Patent Office at any particular point, which has, as we'll talk throughout the course, a number of important effects. Not the least is a very significant political problem for the Patent Office, because they are criticized on the one hand for granting too many patents of dubious quality, and yet at the same time they're being criticized for not processing patents quickly enough to reduce backlog, because backlog, of course, is bad for everybody as well. Another way of looking at the increase in patent activity over the last 20 years is to look at patent intensity. And what I mean by patent intensity is the number of patent applications filed per $1 million of non-federal R&D funding, right? So you take the private sector's funding for research and development, and look at how many patents they are seeking per $1 million, and you see we've gone from somewhere around one patent per $1 million of R&D to more like 1.5, almost 1.6 patents per $1 million. That's a very significant increase over 20 years, and has really meant that there are more patents. People are just getting more patents as research and development has increased throughout this time period. You know, you might ask yourself, is this because research and development is becoming more efficient? We're getting better at creating patentable innovations. Or is it that, as I said earlier, that there's a change in the way that people think about patents, that instead of thinking about patents in terms of their own innovation, their internal innovation, and their internal product development, they're thinking about patents as means to an end of themselves, and they're seeking patents in ways and for things that they might not otherwise 20 years ago. And so this is an important change that's reflected in patent intensity. Along with more patents, of course, and one of the major reasons to study patent law is that there have been very significant increase in patent enforcement. And you can see, in particular in the last 5 years, a very sharp uptick in patent enforcement activity. If you look at it sort of over the 20-year span, you know, we've gone from, you know, around 1,500 patent lawsuits filed in 1994 to, you know, 6,500 or so, 6,600 or so in the calendar year 2013. And that's a pretty big change. That has really meant that patents are being litigated far more. The cases, patent cases, are very complex, very expensive, can often be bet the company type of litigations for the companies involved on both sides, right? Whether you're a patentee or a potential infringer, the determination of patent rights can make or break your company without a doubt. And we're seeing more and more of this very high stakes, very high cost litigation. Now, for all of you who want to become patent lawyers, this is terrific news because even as the legal profession has in recent years seen some pullbacks, patent law in particular has seen none of that and has in fact accelerated its growth over the last few years. This may be changing a little bit just in the last 6 months or so, but it's unclear, and certainly still patents will be important for a long time to come in terms of their enforcement ability. It used to be that patents were enforced less than other areas of intellectual property law, and that's no longer the case. You can see, if you look at the different kinds of federal intellectual property cases, lawsuits filed, trademark has been reasonably steady. Copyright saw a huge jump in the early to mid-1990s as the music industry sought to crack down on file sharing, on music sharing, and some video sharing as well. You're seeing a little bit of a comeback in the copyright industry as well in terms of litigation. But really the big story over the last 20 years in terms of intellectual property law litigation has been the rise of patents, as patents have really taken off as a enforcement mechanism. And again, you can look at the amount of enforcement activities in a variety of ways. You can, again, think of this in terms of litigation intensity per billion of non-federal, how many lawsuits get filed per billion of non-federal U.S. R&D, and this would be, going from 8 to almost 12. Again, a very significant increase over 20 years. Another thing that makes patent law an interesting area to study is that we really don't know very much about it. We don't really know about the true costs of the system and how those stack up against the benefits. We know for sure that the costs of the system are increasing. Certainly all of those graphs that I showed you over the last few minutes should tell you that, right? We are seeing more patents being filed for. That means the patent office is having to get bigger. It's having to work harder, hire more staff, The fees have not risen very much, but they are rising some. So the costs of the system are increasing. Litigation costs are increasing very quickly. Not only are there more patent lawsuits being filed every year, but the lawsuits themselves have become more and more complex, involving more lawyers, more patents, more complexity, more time. Up and down the chain. So we know that the costs of the system are increasing. And the question is whether the benefits are also increasing, right? Because the idea of the patent system is that we have, you know, the patent system incurs certain costs. It's definitely a costly system for the economy, for our country to have. But we think that those costs are justified in terms of benefits, right? That the benefits of the patent system, primarily encouraging people to innovate, to create new inventions and commercialize those inventions, outweigh the costs. And we don't really know if those benefits are increasing to keep pace with the costs, or whether they've lagged behind, or indeed whether they're well out in front of the costs. And therefore, even though we've seen a recent uptick in the costs, the benefits are still larger. So for that reason, the patent system has really emerged over the last several years as an important public policy question. There have been, over the last 10 years, two really important sort of blue ribbon commissions. One, the Federal Trade Commission in October of 2003, and they've since updated that document in 2012, 2013 as well. Took a look at the patent system. The National Research Council, the National Academy of Science also took a look at the patent system and provided a number of important suggestions, many of which we're going to look at during the course. This is the American Invents Act of 2011 that was heavily lobbied, debated over the course of several years in Congress, and ultimately passed in the middle of 2011. And President Obama signed it in September 2011, and most of the provisions are now in effect. Actually, they're all in effect, although some of them have not been in effect for very long. But that was a long and arduous process. There are more proposed bills relating to patent reform that are in various House and Senate committees. At this moment, it's unclear whether any of those will pass, but we'll talk about some of those as well. You've probably heard of patent trolls. This is the idea. There's a hotly debated topic where people say that there's a new breed of litigant out there known as a patent troll. Typically, what people mean by patent trolls are entities that obtain patents without the intent of practicing them, meaning commercializing the invention, but instead with the intent of either litigating or licensing to obtain revenues from those patents. Trolls are a sort of derogatory term based on the sort of ancient fable of the troll that would live under the bridge, and as people would pass over the bridge, would leap out in front and demand payment to pass. And the idea is that trolls sort of lay in wait and jump out once companies that have products become successful and demand payment. And so they're controversial, right? The case for trolls generally is that they have that they're first not necessarily behaving badly in any way. They're simply responding to the incentives of the system, that they can create a secondary market for patents, which has important benefits for, in particular, small inventors or small companies, entrepreneurs who can seek venture capital funding and other types of investment, knowing that there's a secondary market for any intellectual assets that they create. And so this is a topic of great debate that we will talk about throughout the course. President Obama, when he campaigned in 2008, was certainly the first presidential candidate that I can remember who had a specific platform on the patent system and reforms. Not much of his ideas actually made it into law, but it was nonetheless interesting that it was actually a major component of his platform. There are important public resources that have emerged in recent years. If you're interested in reading more about patent law and what's going on a daily basis in the patent law, I recommend the Patentleo blog, which does a good job of covering the news of the patent system. The USPTO has created a number of what they describe as dashboards that allow you to get some insights into what's going on at the PTO. They will tell you things like how long the average pendency is, how long it takes to get a patent in various areas, what the backlog is, how many patents are sitting around waiting for action, how many examiners are currently on staff, and so forth. And so that's the I recommend that you take a look at that if you're interested in sort of an literally up-to-the-minute view of what's going on in the patent system. Moving on to the architecture of the patent system. The patent system has basically three major components. The first is the administrative agency, the United States Patent and Trademark Office. They also do trademarks, but we're not obviously going to talk about that in this class. The task of the PTO, or the USPTO, is to evaluate patent applications for whether or not they comply with the standards of patentability. If they do, they grant the patent. If they don't, then they reject the patent. Not quite so simple, as we'll find out throughout the course, but that's the basic task of the PTO. After the AIA, the PTO also has additional functions, including a post-grant review system whereby interested parties can request that the PTO look at issued patents again and determine their patentability on sort of a second pass approach, and we'll discuss that later in the course as well. But in general, the PTO is the administrative body, one of the largest administrative bodies in the U.S. government, has a specific task of evaluating patent applications for compliance with the standards for patentability under the law. The second sort of big architecture piece of the patent system is the patent document. The patent document establishes everything about what we mean by a patent. It has in it the claim language, which establishes the boundaries of the protection. It has within it the disclosure, which is a statutorily required component of the patent system and enables anyone looking at the document to understand what the claims mean, how the invention is supposed to be used, the context of the invention, some important pieces of prior art, and so forth. We'll go over that a little more in a moment, but the patent document is a critical component as well. And the other major component of the patent system is the system of private enforcement, right? Importantly, having a patent doesn't give you any governmental rights other than the right to seek in federal court to enforce the patent against people you think are infringing it. What this means is the market determines your reward. You don't automatically get money by getting a patent. Instead, the money you may or may not get depends entirely on your willingness and ability to enforce your patent or get people to license your patent. But of course, the reason they would license it is because there's the enforcement possibilities. The other important thing to understand about the litigation and enforcement system is that you, when in litigation, have a full review of what the PTO did, right? So you can review not only whether somebody's infringing a patent and what the boundaries of that patent are, but you can also review, and sometimes on a fully de novo basis, whether or not that patent was validly granted by the PTO, right? So that means that the patent enforcement system, this private litigation enforcement system, is extremely high stakes for both parties. For potential infringers, it's obviously high stakes because being found to infringe a patent can be expensive, can cause you to have to shut down a production plant or something like that. But for the patentee, it can be equally high stakes because the patentee can actually start, it can end up worse than where they started out by virtue of the fact that if you sue somebody for patent infringement, they may defend by saying your patent is invalid, and if you lose on that ground, then you have lost your patent for all time, which means you know it's sort of like suing somebody for trespassing across your lawn and ending up that they own your lawn. So it's a very high stakes operation for enforcement, part of the reason it's so complex. Moving on to the patent document, just wanted to highlight a few critical areas. A patent document is sort of a case study in information design. The idea in particular is that the front page of the patent document is supposed to tell you a great deal of information about the patent itself. This dates back to earlier eras when there weren't as good of electronic databases, and people would search for patents, search for whether or not particular innovations had been patented by looking essentially through the physical files kept at the patent office of the patent documents themselves. And so the patent documents are designed to allow you to look at the front page and almost at a glance understand a lot about that patent very quickly. And so a few key things: title and serial number, right? Every patent has an individual number. They're sequentially ordered in the order in which they are granted, and that's in the upper right corner. Every patent must have a title that generally describes the invention. It's not a binding title in the sense that it doesn't provide any scope or protection. It's just supposed to accurately describe what the invention is. Key dates are shown on the front page. The filing date, the priority date, and the issue date, right? The date of filing is, of course, the date that you file the patent. Priority date means if you take advantage of any particular earlier filed patent applications. We'll talk about this later in the course, but there's a way that you can take advantage of a patent application you filed, say, a couple of years ago, and take advantage of that date for prior art purposes. So if that occurs, you can see that on the front page of the document as well. As well as the issue date, right? The issue date is the upper right corner, tells you the date the patent was issued, which has a number of important features as well. The inventors and assignees are up in the upper left corner. Inventor, of course, is obvious, whoever invented the patent. All patents have to be invented by real people. You can't have corporate inventors, and more than one person can be a joint, so you can have, it can be an inventor, so you can have joint inventorship. And in fact, if a invention is jointly made, all inventors are required to be listed. However, inventors are presumed to own the patent, but they don't have to own the patent. And the person who or entity who owns the patent is known as the assignee. And the assignee is shown, if it's available at the time, on the cover of the patent document as well. The technology fields, the classes, are shown on the cover of the patent document. What this means is that the patent office has a classification scheme, a classification system, where every field of technology is represented by a series of numbers. And when you file a patent application, there's an entire division of the PTO that evaluates the content of the subject matter of your patent application and files it into particular technology fields known as classes, technology classes. That determines where your patent application gets assigned for examination, gets sent to a particular office or division of the PTO, depending on the subject matter. It also determines where that examiner that is assigned to review your application is going to search. So the system allows both the allocation of patents for examination purposes as well as the ability to search former patents and patent applications for prior art purposes. Any references cited are listed on the front page. It may not be a complete list, but in general, the examiner is supposed to list them in the order of importance. So more important ones should be on the front page. Lesser important ones will be on subsequent pages. That, again, tells you, gives you some context and ability to figure out what fields, what area, who else is involved in the patenting in that area. And then an abstract. An abstract is basically a as you would expect, a short overview of the invention. In general, the abstract is not binding in terms of the patent scope. So indeed, patentees will often write abstract descriptions of their invention in a manner that's quite broad, making people think that the invention that they've invented is larger, more significant than it actually is. But in any event, the abstract is supposed to reflect what the invention is. Other parts of the patent document that are not on the front page are the drawings. Every patent should have a drawing if it would illuminate the aspects of the invention that are important. The specification is the written part of the patent. Starts on the subsequent pages and includes all of the description of the invention, how it relates to prior art, what the actual innovation is, what the various embodiments of the invention might be, are all in the patent document. And then at the end are the claims. It would be difficult to overstate how important claims are to the patent system. And one of the things that a lot of people who aren't particularly familiar with patents don't understand is that it's the claims that determine almost everything about a patent. Claims are required to, as the statute says, particularly point out and distinctly claim the invention. The claims don't have to tell you how to make or use the invention. That's what the rest of the patent application is all about. But the claims are supposed to define the scope of the invention. Right? And so you can see on the right side of the slide here an example claim. What is claimed is a vehicle for carrying a payload including a user, the vehicle comprising a platform which supports the user, a ground contacting module to which the platform is mounted, a motorized drive arrangement, a balancing margin monitor, and alarm. This is the way that patent claims are written. Patent claims are a single sentence, basically the world's longest run-on sentences you've ever seen. Patent claims are typically divided, as you see on the example here. Sometimes they have the ABC components, often they don't, but they typically are divided into subcomponents for ease of reading and understanding. We often call those subcomponents elements or limitations. More about that later in the course. The claim language is the defining component of what a patent is. It defines the scope of the invention, which means it defines exactly whether or not that patent is valid, whether it separates itself from the prior art enough, whether it's fully described in the patent specification as required. It also defines how much coverage you get as the owner of the patent, how much of what subject areas are going to fall within the scope of the patent and then be potentially excludable in a enforcement action. It's important, as you're thinking about patents and patent claims, to understand that patent claims are written by the patentee, The patent applicant writes the patent claims. Now, the patent office, the patent examiner, will reject claims if he or she believes they don't meet the standards for patentability. But at the end of the day, the patentee is still the one who gets to decide what exactly goes into those claims or does not go into those claims. So one of the things to keep in mind is what the incentives are here. What are the goals of claim language for the patentee, right? Patentees, of course, have a goal for claims of being broad, right? Because the broader the claim, the more subject matter exclusion you get. And therefore, the more valuable your patent is, the more protection you have in the marketplace, the better asset it is, and so forth. At the same time, a patentee can't claim too broadly. I can't claim the entire world as part of my patent. Why? Because it would run afoul of prior art and it would be an invalid patent. So I have to, as a patentee, walk this line between wanting to be as broad as I can and at the same time making sure I don't claim too much and thereby have an invalid patent claim, right? So what's my incentive as a patentee? Well, as we will find out, and this is just to give sort of a preview of a lot of what's going to go on in the course, patentees would then have a pretty strong incentive to be rather vague about their patents, right? Because one of the ways you can walk this line and have a broad language claim and at the same time a claim that doesn't cover too much prior art is to be vague, because that way you can describe your invention to the PTO when it's being examined against the prior art and for disclosure as a fairly narrow invention. And then later on, when it's issued, when it's a granted patent, you can turn around and argue that it in fact means something more broad. And that is something that unfortunately is a strong incentive and something that's difficult to prevent under the current patent law. And indeed, much of patent doctrine is intended to try and cabin this incentive. The public, on the other hand, has quite a different standard or quite a different set of incentives for patent claims. The public would like patent claims to be as clear as possible, right? You might think about the ideal patent claim as being something akin to a land deed, right? Something where you say, you know, walk 50 paces, turn right 90 degrees, walk 50 more paces. So you get a nice, clean separation between what is owned and what is not owned. That's what the public would like. That way, you know what the scope of the patent is when you're looking at it. You also know what the scope of the patent is not. And therefore, if you're a competitor, you know whether you need to take a license or whether you need to avoid practicing in that particular subject matter area or whether you are free to go forward and do whatever you want because the patent doesn't cover it. So the public and the patentee have very different goals with respect to patent claim language, right? Much of the incentives push patentees towards vague and obtuse claim language, whereas the public would like it to be clearer, more crisp, more certain. And you're going to see this struggle between what the public wants from the patent and what the patentee wants from the patent play itself out across a number of the patent doctrines throughout the course. And so that's a bit of a preview of what we're going to talk about. So a quick overview of the life of the patent. Right? The life of a patent is as follows. At some point, the invention gets invented. Right, whether it's by a research and development process or some other, unclear, but the invention gets invented. And then the application is filed. There's an application that's created. Again, the patentee creates this, the patentee drafts this, often with the assistance of patent attorneys, but not necessarily. It is possible to file your own patent without having an attorney. You can represent yourself before the PTO. The phase when it's being reviewed by the PTO is the prosecution, what's known as the prosecution phase, the patent prosecution phase. Currently, it's 30 to 36 months on average of prosecution. Once your patent is granted, it will be issued. The claims that are granted will be issued, and the patent document will be published by the PTO. Thereupon, you enter the enforcement phase, at which point you can file lawsuits, if you wish, against those people you think may have, or entities you think may have infringed your patent, in any federal court in which you can get good venue until the patent expires. The patent term is 20 years from the date of the application at this point. Until the mid-90s, it was 17 years from the date of issue, but now it's 20 years from the date of application. Once the patent expires, the content of the subject matter, the entire thing, is in the public domain, can no longer be protected by any means. So in the prosecution phase is an ex parte, generally an ex parte phase. There are some small exceptions to this. It's generally private or secret, although most patent applications are published after 18 months. There are ways you can prevent this, but in general, we think of most patent applications, whether the patent has been granted at that time or not, they get published. The snapshot of where they are at the 18-month period gets published. The procedures in the prosecution phase allow for what's known as continuing applications, meaning that even if the patent examiner rejects all of your patent claims, and even if they reject them repeatedly, you can continue to fight. You can file additional applications. You can request additional bites at the apple, basically. So patent applicants can get many bites at the apple, and it makes it somewhat difficult for the PTO to ultimately reject patents. And we think around 75% of all applications eventually result in some form of a patent. The grant rate, the PTO calls this a grant rate, is generally much lower, something more like 50 or 60%. The numbers vary a fair amount. But what that often means is that the original application gets abandoned because you file a new application, and that new application contains many of the same claims. And so it's a relatively complex process of tracing back exactly where you started to where you end up. But we think that in most cases, about 75% of the time when you file for a patent application, you get some version of your invention protected. There are internal procedural incentives at the PTO to issue patents. Until fairly recently, there were very strong incentives for patent examiners to issue patents because they were evaluated in part on how much work they did, and how much work they did could be shown to be particularly significant if they granted more patents. There have been some reforms of that process recently. But overall, of course, the Patent Office has an incentive to grant patents. We talked earlier about the tremendous backlog involved at the PTO. That's a political problem. So the PTO has strong incentives to decrease backlog. And if in a world where people can continue to fight no matter how many times the PTO rejects them, one of the easiest ways to decrease backlog would be to simply issue patents, which is a potential public policy problem that we'll talk about as the course goes on. There are two-stage appeals. If you don't like what the patent examiner is doing, you can appeal his or her decision internally to the Board of Patent Appeals and Interferences, otherwise known as the Board, which is an internal process of appeal. You can also file a lawsuit against the PTO in a particular kind of civil action in the district court, and both of those processes can be ultimately appealed to the Federal Circuit, which takes appeals directly from the PTO, again, as well as all district court patent cases. There's a reexamination process as well as a post-grant review process. We'll talk about those later in the course. The enforcement process is federal court litigation. As I noted before, the courts are fully empowered to review what the PTO has done, meaning they can determine the validity of patents. But patents enjoy a statutory presumption of validity, meaning it takes a higher standard of evidence to overcome a patent once it's already been issued than it does in prosecution. And so it's not as easy as you might think to eliminate an invalid patent in federal litigation. Declaratory judgment actions are actually quite common in the patent context. For those of you who forget your first year civil procedure, declaratory judgment actions are essentially a lawsuit in reverse, where the potential defendant in a patent infringement action would file a suit in federal court asking for a declaration that he or she does not infringe the patent, and or that the patent that's being asserted against them, even if it hasn't been, even if a lawsuit has not been filed against them, they can assert that that patent is invalid. The reason it's fairly common in the patent system is because the stakes are high on both sides and often fairly symmetric. I mean, typically, declaratory judgment actions are not very popular for defendants. Why would you want to initiate a lawsuit when you didn't have to? In the patent context, you might be much more willing to initiate a lawsuit. For one thing, you might have substantial investments that you want to make in, for example, a production facility or a distribution line or marketing materials that you want to make sure you're going to be allowed to use prior to allowed to use. So you need to clear the patent that might be in your way. The other thing is, if somebody has a potentially troublesome patent for your business out there, you can file a declaratory judgment action and get that patent declared invalid, if you think it's invalid, and thereby improve your position vis-a-vis the marketplace overall. So for that reason, declaratory judgment actions are pretty common. And in fact, a couple of the recent Supreme Court cases have involved what the scope of declaratory judgment jurisdiction is in the patent context. So some key facts and figures. I showed you a few earlier on the trends in the patent system, but we know that less than 1% of all patents get litigated during their lifetime. We estimate, we don't know for sure, but we estimate that less than 5% of all patents are licensed. Now, that doesn't mean that there's fewer, that only 5% of patents are worth anything, because, of course, a lot of patents are used, as they have traditionally been, by the companies that own them to protect themselves in the marketplace, so they have certainly some economic value in that sense. But it is absolutely the case that many patents, and in fact, the average expected value of most patents is almost certainly less than zero. And we also know that the distribution of patent value is heavily skewed. What I mean by that is a few patents have extreme value, but most have very little or no value at all. And in fact, most patents probably have less value than the cost to obtain them. And that then creates a bit of a puzzle as to why so many patents would be filed on a yearly basis. There are a variety of theories of why this might be the case, most of them involving changed understandings of what patents' values actually are. But just one thing to take away from this slide is that most patents probably have negative expected value. And very few of patents have extremely high value. Litigation in patent system is very expensive. Typically, $4.5 million per side for cases that have more than $25 million at stake, which is a lot of the patent cases. And even the smallest type of patent case is going to be in the millions of dollars. This is because they're complicated. They have long discovery processes. They are cases that are difficult to try and require specialized skill sets among the attorneys, so they tend to be quite expensive. Turning finally to course administration. So we're going to use the law school's Canvas course management system again this year. It's been in place for a few years, and although we're all sort of still getting used to it, many of the bugs have been worked out. I have a short URL to get to it. All the assignments, the syllabus, any downloads that I want you to read, all of that kind of stuff, that's all going to be through Canvas. Let me know if you have any trouble there. We will As the semester progresses, use some of the Canvas systems, such as the announcement system, the discussion and collaboration tools, as part of our class exercises. So I'm hoping to really try and use Canvas the way it's intended to be used as part of this course. The readings, most of the readings will be in the casebook. It's a what I think is a really good casebook by Professor Nard from Case Western. Make sure you get the third edition. There's the second edition is floating around out there, but there certainly are a lot of changes, and I think enough changes to make it worth upgrading to the third edition. If you really must, you can probably get away by just matching up the cases that I assign for reading with what's in the second edition plus some downloads, but I think it would be probably be in your interest to get the third edition. There'll be some supplemental materials as well, which I will assign from time to time. They'll all be electronic, of course, and available through the system, the Canvas system. The statute is just Title 35. I haven't required you to buy a statutory supplement book. That sort of is up to you, whether you like to have that in hard copy or not. You can certainly download PDF versions from a variety of sources or various online versions of the statute, and so I leave that to your own discretion. As I noted in the intro video, this is a special kind of class. It's what's known as a flipped class. What this means is that there's going to be assigned readings in these pre-recorded lectures that happen prior to class. You are expected to do these readings prior to coming to class on the Tuesday of each week. And I will try and stay several weeks ahead on the readings and the lectures. All the readings are actually pretty much set up by now. Some of the lectures still need to be modified or adapt it. I'm going to try this year some short quizzes, probably 5 questions each time, just to test basic reading comprehension and to provide incentives for people to come to that first class of the week having read all of the material, because I think that you will get a lot more out of the class exercises that I've put together by doing that. The way that the week is going to run, we have 3 class sessions. This is a 4-credit class. So we have 3 class sessions per week. On Tuesday, we're going to do a quick overview of the subject matter of the week. Not a full-scale lecture of what the subject is, but a real quick, maybe 5 to 10 minute overview of what I'd like you to understand. Then we'll go over any question and answers, anything that anyone saw that they didn't understand, or any clarifications about the substance that needs to be done. And then we'll introduce the exercise. Every week is going to have a class exercise that's designed to extend and apply the subject matter of that week. And so we'll introduce that on Tuesday. On Wednesday, this is for meetings as a group. You'll be assigned groups to do these exercises. You will use the Wednesday time slot to meet as a group to discuss the exercise. Your instructors will be available during that Wednesday time slot, but we won't be lecturing or holding class. There's a classroom set aside for these meetings. Our classroom should be available for you as a physical space. You don't necessarily have to show up in that classroom if you would prefer to meet with your team elsewhere, or even meet with your team electronically or something like that. We leave it to you, but we would just wanted to make sure that there was a particular time that you could meet with your team to work on the exercise. And the idea of the exercises would be that they will take some work, but probably not a ton more work than what should be done between the in-class time Tuesday, Wednesday, and some on Thursday. So Thursday is the implementation of the exercise day. So whatever the outcome is, sometimes it's a presentation, sometimes it's a mock argument, sometimes it's a class discussion. Depending on the exercise week, we may give you some portion of the Thursday class to also meet with your teams. That'll sort of vary week by week, but the idea on Thursday is that this is when sort of the exercise payoff happens, and we will then answer any questions talk about next week and then adjourn for the week. Right. So the basic idea of the flipped class is that you read and watch the lectures beforehand, and then the class sessions themselves are used for other things. What this means for you as a student is that there's a lot more outside of class work. The inside class work is more interesting and probably more beneficial, although we're trying to make it even more beneficial. I guess we'll get your feedback on how much more beneficial it is, but there will be. It's important to keep up with this class, right? It's important to do the readings beforehand. There'll be these assignment and exercises, the team meetings, and to prepare. You'll get a ton out of this class, much more than you will out of any other law school class, I can assure you. But it will be some additional work, and this is part of the reason that it's a 4-credit advanced class. The grading scale is as follows. There will be a final exam. Typically, that's mostly multiple choice, so I expect it'll be that as well, along with some short answer essay as well. The exercises and assignments are going to be scored as well, and they're going to be worth 20% of your grade. When you work as a team in general, the whole team's going to get the same score, so make sure that you work well as groups. The quizzes are going to be 7.5%, and I'll let you drop your lowest score, so if there's a week that you either just don't get to the quiz or do particularly poorly on the reading comprehension metrics, you can drop that. And then course participation, meaning overall course participation, how well you participate in the class Q&A, how well you participate in your groups and in the exercises, as well as any online collaboration type discussions, are going to be part of that participation score as well. So next week is our first week, and so we will be, the topic for the first week is the history, theory, and economics of the patent system. Again, sort of an overview, but really getting down into what makes the patent system different in the U.S. From other types of federal laws, and what makes it work from an economic and theoretical perspective. And so I will see you next time.